Oh boy. We got him. Mm-hmm. By we, I mean Nick.
Yeah, great job, Nikki.
Those bitten, anxiety-ridden thumbs just hit the IG and fucking hooked our white whale, Barrie, and his slave, Scotty.
It was fun.
Thank you. Great job.
Yeah, I can't believe it.
I had stomach issues during most of the interview. And
yeah.
It's all right. It went well, Nick.
It went really good. Barry's a combative young man. He made fun of my weight, which I welcomed because I need all the.
I don't think you're that heavy. Get. And by the way, don't throw rocks at glass.
He's out, a sea cow. I mean? But listen, you are not going to be able to listen to the entirety of it because that's not what we here to do, baby. I don't know why
I like it.
I don't know why you're selling I did me. That voice.
You're selling
right?
me.
But you're going to hear a little bit of a little snippet of it. Okay. I think we'll cut it right before me and Barrie fight about salmon and teriyaki and his disgusting, filthy trash palate. If you want to hear the full interview and our entire coverage of Below Deck Sailing Yacht, go to patreon.com/anotherpodcastnetwork. We missed this feed. We'll see you guys soon. When Sandy and her crew of ragtag ragamuffins go ramming ships into icebergs in Iceland or whatever the fuck they're going to do. But until then, the only place you're going to hear us is patreon.com/anotherpodcastnetwork.
So fucking pull the trigger. Jesus fucking Christ.
All right, let's listen to our chat with Barrie and his slave. Okay, you guys ready to talk to us about Below Deck?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. All right, we got him. Barrie and fiance, boyfriend, husband, we'll talk Are about you? It. Scotty?
Just say Shag. Shag's fine.
Yeah, this.
What? Say what?
Just say Shag.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you guys very, very much for joining us. We appreciate you taking the time. Are you in Jolly Old? Are you in Florida? Where are you guys?
We're in Tampa right now.
Ugh, disgusting. How is it?
It's disgusting, but it's not bad.
Yeah.
Not bad at all.
Okay, good. So, hey, I want to start off light, and then we'll kind of ramp up into the more sensitive stuff. But first off, how'd you fall in love with your daughter's boyfriend?
Well, if my daughter ever brings a boyfriend home, I might have the opportunity.
Okay.
You didn't.
I'm sensing, can I ask you this, Barrie? Were they not that serious? More like friends? Was that the nature of the relationship?
Well, you can ask Scott yourself, but let me give you my take on it. So Scott came to work for me years ago. And actually, I've been bumming him for much longer than he says in the newspapers. That's the truth. I mean, let's get to the nitty gritty. Don't even wait till the end of the fucking show. Let's just get straight to it.
I like it.
I've been bumming him for years. That's the thing. So, you know, him and Saffron are best mates.
Yeah.
And Scott didn't want to come out as gay to his parents and all of his mates and all of that. And she pretended to be his boyfriend. And unfortunately, it got so blown up in the press that it kind of just ran away with itself. And that's where it is, really.
Oh, okay. So Saffron was a beard. She was a cloak.
But
he was a fag hag.
A fag hag, a fruit fly.
Okay, got it. Scotty, does that, that's pretty much an accurate accounting of everything?
At the time, I wasn't comfortable within who I was with my sexuality. I was still trying to work out what I liked. And Saffron was always there for me to talk to. So she became a best mate. We'd done everything together. We go shopping together and things like that. And she came a comfort blanket and she just helped me out and agreed to just do a few bits and pieces. And then obviously the media and the newspapers caught a hold of that. And okay. It just all flared up into something.
I'm sure even if you were dating Saffron, though, you guys, Barrie and Scott, have a relationship like Vince and E from Entourage, where E knows if he brings a girl around Vince, she better not come in the no-fly zone.
Yeah, you guys know what he's talking about, right?
No idea.
Okay. Don't worry about it. Barrie, let me ask you this. You being as the business owner and Scotty being your employee, when you guys were making the jump into this relationship, was there some hesitation that there would be some pushback, whether in the press? I mean, your name's out there. Was it a surprise to you when it kind of blew up as much as it did?
He definitely blew up. But what do you mean, him being an employee and all that?
You well, you like, had mentioned he worked for you for a number of years.
Yeah, but I had no hesitation. I wanted to fuck him, and so I did.
All right.
You know,
when cool. Listen, sometimes it goes like that, you know. Now, Scotty, do you feel uncomfortable with the ownership that he takes over you? Because you're kind of, I don't know. Sorry, wait, we didn't hear you.
I said, what are you saying? He's just my bitch. Just say it.
No, I'm not. I don't want to. I'm implying just that. I'm implying it. Yeah.
Fuck's sake, if I was coming on with three fucking heavyweights here.
You are, man. We're heavyweights, Barrie.
I will blame the Zoom audio for missing a lot of our joke.
There it is again. Humpty Dumpty and his crew. Come on, put it up a notch.
All right. Okay. So,
I have some listener questions. They're fans.
We don't want to get to listener questions yet. How do you guys feel about the cut that you got on this this arc of episodes? To be honest, we kind of want you off the show because we want to get back to the ball of snakes that is the fucking and the sucking with the crew. That's kind of...
We like when the crew fuck people.
Yeah, exactly. So you guys had a pretty long arc. It's three episodes. That doesn't usually happen. But how do you feel about the cut that you guys got? Because you come off like, you know, kind of a dickhead, but I'm sure that you're, you know, you're comfortable with that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I enjoy being everybody's dickhead.
Okay.
Everybody the common enemy. And if they want to use me as the whipping boy, happy days.
So sure. Barrie, none of what you were doing on the show were to get a reaction out of the audience. I mean, I'm sensing you are the same person on the show, just talking to you for a few minutes, but did you put it on a little bit for the camera?
Nah.
You did.
I'm a cop in real life as well. So.
Got it. Well, I'm kind of the culinary guy on the show. I'm very preoccupied with the food. I don't think that nine people should ever be allowed on that boat, period.
Too small.
It's too small. It's too much work for chefs that are boat chefs at the end of the day. So there's a ceiling there that's pretty fucking low. But I have to ask you, you know, you purport to be a man of many millions and fine taste. You have private chefs. I'm sure you've dined at Michelin stars all over the place. Salmon and teriyaki is revolting. It's revolting. It sounds disgusting. Where does that come from?
You look like somebody who likes food. So
I've been eating a tremendous amount over quarantine.
Well,
yes,
we can see that absolutely. But what I'm saying is, each to his own. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you don't like something, I ain't gonna fucking bother you about what you eat and what you don't eat. Don't you bother me. If I want beans on toast with a fucking fried egg at the side, that's what I'm gonna have.
You would admit, though, that it's a pretty filthy, trashy combination.
Well, it might be for you, but it might not be for me. That's
this
the point.
It's just as filthy as that fucking mustache.
Okay. Oh, you guys are a teammate. There's a lot of loyalty here. It's kind of like it's Stockholm syndrome. It's like a slave and his master. It's very terrifying.